The Upbeat Podcast. I'm your host, Drew Smith. Welcome back for this another week of another episode. My man, Delroy Gill in the building. How you doing, brother?
I'm doing good, man. Good. How you doing?
Good, good. Thank you for coming.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
I haven't dressed up like this after Friday at hard work. I had to sit there and impress you, man.
Man, you're good. You're looking good, man.
I was looking on your Instagram, man, and I was telling one of my friends, man, he liked the Conor McGregor of Colorado. Man, his suits are just always out there, man.
Oh, but, man, that's funny.
I appreciate you coming, man. I'm very excited. Like I said before, while we was walking up to the studio, I came across your profile and I was introduced to you by my wife, who works at Studio Thomas with Kristen Thomas. So shout out to Kristen Thomas and
shout
the whole studio
out, squad.
Very, very good people over
Definitely.
There. So Delroy, how long have you been here in the States?
Man, all my answers might be way too long because my story.
We got time, brother. We got time.
Loop around, but. How long have I been in the States? I've been coming to America, no pun intended, for 20 years.
Okay.
Yeah, about 20 years now. So originally from London, England, and then first came to Colorado in 1998. So literally 20 years this year.
Okay.
But when I first moved here, I was kind of back and forth. It was a culture shock. Like, it's way different. Like, especially, like, for the viewers or whatever, but 20 years ago in Denver, it was nothing like Denver today. Like, when I came here, there was dirt roads, a lot of this stuff wasn't here,
right.
You know, restaurants weren't as good, the bars weren't as good, nothing was the same.
Now, how old were you when you came here?
I was 17.
17.
Yeah, so 17 years old, and then I came, and when I got here, the schooling system was even way different, because when we're in England, we graduate school when we're 16.
Oh, wow.
So I had finished high school at that time, and then when I got to America, they were like, oh well, you can go to like Arapahoe Community College, or you can go to high school, because like you have your papers or whatever to go start going to college,
right.
Kind of get some credits and then go to university, or you could just go to high school. So I'm like, I'll go back to high school. Like, I've already like got my papers. I can just enjoy one more year of high school, meet people my age. Because I was just thinking in my mind, like, I don't want to go to college and there's all old people. I'm 17.
Right.
So I went to high school, kind of got to experience like that whole high school lifestyle of America, which is completely different from London as well.
So when how does that work over there? I mean, so because I mean, we graduate here 17, 18, and you said you were 16 over there.
Yeah.
So are the grades different? Are they viewed different? Or is everything just the same? They just kind of, you know,
it's
shorten the
they just shorten it. I think like in London or in big cities, or I'm surprised how it works in places like New York or in different like really big cities. But like the culture is just different in London. Like when you're 16 in London, like maturity wise and like going and getting a job, like you're 100% ready. Like you're right. out there either making a decision to take this internship, to take an apprenticeship, get a real job, go to college, university. Like mindset wise, you're already there. Whereas I think like in America, you can't drink until you're a certain age. You can't do certain things until you're a certain ages. So I think like that gap in between is like in London, we don't really have it. Like we're ready to go.
Right.
So even when I came here and I was 17, like I was like, whoa, like you're still doing that? Like we were doing that when we were like 15. Like we don't, or people, and people don't, like drinking is not that of a big thing. It kind of is now a little bit, but when I was growing up, like getting drunk and doing that type of stuff in London, it's just not even really.
I guess, and that makes a good point. Cause I guess, I mean, I had a friend who went over there to, you know, Ireland a while back, and he was like, yeah, we went to a bar and there was, you know, 16-year-olds in the bar, but they didn't act 16.
Right.
You know,
right.
And I think that's because here in America, I mean, we'll say it, you know, we're under 21. You know,
right.
If you're under 21, you can't drink, you do the rebel thing.
Exactly.
I'm gonna drink.
Yeah.
So it causes
us
to be more immature, you know.
Exactly.
Immature.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
What caused you guys to come over here to America?
So my stepdad got a job transfer to a technology company. Mm-hmm. Which was actually in Nebraska. And like I visited Nebraska. Anybody who's from Nebraska, shout out to you. But I was like, there's no way this London boy can live in Nebraska.
Right.
So like as soon as I went there, I was like, no, I'm going back home. And I left and we all went back. And then, so he was kind of figuring things out with the jobs and then got moved around a bit to Chicago. We was in Chicago for a little while. Then we were in Florida for a little while, like no more than a year in any of these places.
Right.
And then kind of just went online, was searching like cool places to live in America, where's the best place? And then at the time, like Yahoo said, like Denver, like it was the best place to raise a family and live in 1998. So then they just picked up, moved here. And then we were still going through kind of immigration and all of that at that time, getting our papers. So I couldn't really, even if I wanted to, even if I didn't like it, which I didn't really that much,
right.
I couldn't leave anyway. So I had to stay in school, get that, go through the process.
And then leave
and
if
then,
you wanted
and
to.
Yeah, and then as soon as, like literally the day I got my green card, I booked the ticket and went back home.
Went back
the
home.
Same day.
How did you like Chicago?
Chicago was cool. I actually liked it because it's more similar to London. But I was like when you're like 15, 16, I don't have that much memory like of everything that was going on and like you're moving country, like stuff was just a little bit overwhelming probably. So, but I remember it being a cool place and it just, I think probably reminded my family and everyone
a
of
little
like
bit back home.
Too much home.
Yeah, I'm actually heading to Chicago at the end of, at the beginning of August for me and the wife are going to Lollapalooza. It's a music festival out there.
I think so, I've heard of it
before.
Yeah,
it's like a 4-day, you know, all the big names are going to be there and everything like
that'd
that.
Be cool.
So, yeah, I mean, I love Chicago. I've been out there once, but yeah, it's a good city. London, tell us about London. I mean, do you miss it back? Do you go back often?
Yeah, London, I used to go back every year.
Okay.
But then I kind of stopped for a little while. I was actually there though last year. And I had like a gap where my kids were younger. We were going there all the time and like it wasn't a vacation anymore. I was going there like, to like travel around. You got to see all the family. You're going up here, down there, and everybody wants you to come to their house and eat dinner. And it was like, it wasn't a vacation and it's not cheap to go to London every time, especially I got three kids as well. So traveling. But then this last time when I went back last year, like my kids are older. My son's 13, my daughter's 10, and then I had a 1-year-old. So I wanted to bring them to see the baby, but then just kind of go in there and see in London through my teenage son's eyes and my daughter's eyes. Like they were so excited about it, get to meet their cousins and their family and all that stuff. So, because I was saying before that trip, I was like, I don't think I'd ever go back to London again.
No.
Like, I would never go back just because I've grew up there. I've been there. Like, there's so many places in the world I can travel to at this point. So why not go somewhere else?
Yeah.
So, but London is, it's a cool place, man. It's a big city. There's always something going on. There's the best, to me, the best food in the world because you got everything. You got your home cooking. You got your Caribbean. You got your Asian. You got African. You got any type of food.
So it's almost like here. It's almost like here how you have, you know, you go to, you know, I'll just use as an example, it's probably the easiest, but, you know, you go to Mexico, it's mostly, you know, Hispanic and Mexican food. You know, you go to Jamaica, you got your Jamaica food. So in London, you kind of, does London have a particular, like, type of food? Like, is there London food or is it kind of just...
London, like, England, in England, the national dish is curry chicken and rice.
Like,
so that's like even Indian, like they don't have the, like they have their food, but like English food is not good food, but the all of the different cultures that are there are the real authentic food choices that you get. So I wouldn't eat English food, but I eat the food that is there by everyone from all over the world.
Now, is your whole family from England? Or have they all been there, or are they?
Yeah, so my actual heritage, my family background is from Jamaica.
Okay.
So my dad was born in Jamaica. My mom's mom was born in Jamaica.
Now, I didn't know that. I didn't know you.
I'm Jamaican.
Just pulled that from from there. I've been there once. Beautiful.
Yeah, where
beautiful
did you go when you were there?
I was 15 and we were on a cruise ship. So they took us to that waterfall where you all where
Dunn's River.
Right, yeah, we went there and everything like
He's probably in Montego Bay.
Yeah. My dad took me. My dad went on a cruise, first time, and he went out there and he kind of wilded out. So when we got older, he's like, I want to take you to Jamaica.
Yeah.
So it was weird. He dropped me and my brother off. And, you know, the excursions, they drop you off.
Right.
He was like, all right, we'll be back in a little bit. And we never thought about it. And years later, he came and told us that he met someone out there when he first went, and the guy took him to Kingston. And they're like, what are you doing in Kingston?
Oh, yeah. Like, if you meet the right people, they'll take... Like, Jamaica's a place where they, like, some stuff they think you think is scary, but, like, right. if you got a local taking you around, you're just not off wandering, like, you'll be good. And they never really mess with tourists, to be honest. Like, yeah. They know, like, they'll be in big trouble if they mess with tourists. So.
Yeah, I love Jamaica. But, so, family, you were from Jamaica. Yep. Your dad, right?
My dad's born... My mom is as well, heritage-wise, Jamaica, but she was born in London.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then so your dad moved there from there, and then your mom was born there?
Yeah, her mom, so my mom's...
Your grandmother, right?
Yeah, my grandmother on my mom's side was born in Jamaica. Then she immigrated to England and then had my mom. Nice. So my mom's born in London, my dad's born in Jamaica, but both Jamaican heritage.
Right. Awesome.
Yeah. I grew up full Jamaican culture. Rice and peas, jerk chicken, fried plant, and all that.
I have two nieces who their dad is Indian and Jamaican.
Oh, yeah. That's what my dad is.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. So,
I'm a coolie as well.
Seeing them grow up and everything like that, they be speaking to me that they're Jamaican accents. Sometimes it's hard. You know, it's already hard enough to tell them apart, you know, because they're identical twins.
Yeah.
And then when they sometimes have that Jamaican accent, I'm like, wait, what'd you guys say? And they're like, they're four now. So, you know, they're right at that age, you know.
Yeah.
Do you still stay in tune with everything like that? The only reason why I'm asking is because I don't know if you know who he is, but I'm a big Anthony Joshua fan.
Oh yeah, the boxer.
I love Anthony Joshua. So you know, anytime he comes on the TV or anything, that's my boy.
Yeah,
very big into boxing and MMA. Those are my two passions and everything like that. So that's my go-to guy over there.
I'm into sports, not that big of a sports follower, but I know who the big name, he's a big name. Right. He's supposed to be coming up soon to fight the American guy. There's a bit of
the
tension.
Wilder. Wilder, exactly. Yes. So we'll see. I'll be rooting for Josh.
Josh, all right, we got you on our side.
Yes. So how did you get into the whole real estate? Because I see that's a big, it would take up most of the time in your life, and I'll also get into, you know, the Denver Gents and everything but how did you get into the whole real estate? What caught your eye and everything?
I've always known I was going to be in real estate. Like,
really?
I mean, probably from as young as, I want to say, like 12, 13 years old, like, I just knew. I didn't exactly know, like, I was going to be a real estate agent or investor or whatever, but I just was like, real estate is going to be my thing. Like, I've always liked buildings. I kind of see my dad like be remodeling houses and do things like that, and I just thought it was cool. They used to make me work on houses with them, so like, even at that time I probably didn't enjoy it as much. So my kid, they make me pick up bricks and do stuff, but I learned a lot and kind of just always been around it. So just more and more, like, I never wanted a job. Like, I've never been like, oh, I'm going to go to university and get that job.
Right.
Like, I just never even had that mindset at all, ever. Mm-hmm. Like, I was just like, oh, what am I going to do to make money? Like, how am I going to make money? That was kind of more of my thought process when I was growing up. So then I just did a bunch of different kind of entrepreneurial stuff. Sold watches, CDs, everything when I was growing up. And then when I did officially kind of move to America, I met up with this other guy. Well, somebody referred me. So this guy was in the real estate industry, but he was doing like website, more technology stuff. Because I thought I was going to do technology stuff for a little bit too, kind of just with computers. I was into computers and stuff. But so he was like, yeah, I've got a technology company. I sell websites. So I was like, oh, I can sell stuff. Like, that's what I do. I'm a sales guy. So he was like, all right. And then he trained me on the software and I was like, cool. Cause I want to learn about real estate anyway and how it works in America. So I didn't even know, like, that was really more of a sales job, but I just heard it was to do with real estate and I was like, cool, I'm going to do that. And then I'll get into real estate through this job. And then basically I was probably 19 at the time. And he was actually from England too. He was the VP of marketing from IBM. This guy was like, he's a major guy.
Right.
But so he was an entrepreneur now, set up this company. So me and him kind of teamed up. He trained me on the product. I was selling it to real estate agents. So I would call up, and he would like create these websites, and real estate agents would sign up and say, I want a website, or I need some more leads.
Right.
And I'll call up and basically tell them how the technology would work for them.
Right.
And the product was actually like, are you familiar with, what's the app? Nextdoor. You know Nextdoor? There's an app. It's called Nextdoor, but it's like a community app. It's like a Facebook group for your neighborhood.
Oh, okay.
Every neighborhood has one, so you could just download the app and if you want to know. So
right.
The software at the time was like that for real estate agents. So basically, a real estate agent would have control over that, and everyone in the neighborhood would sign up. So if you're a real estate agent, you can now send your business card or email or stuff to everyone in the area. So that's what I would sell. So that was going so well. I thought I would do it for like 2 or 3 years and then get into real estate. But I ended up doing that for like maybe 7-8 years.
Wow.
Because it was like, at that time, that was when the real estate market in America was like on the massive run up. Mm-hmm. So it was booming. Real estate was booming. I was literally like, no joke, I was in my house just like getting leads of real estate agents, calling them up, sitting in my home in my PJs and like making money
right.
as like a 19-year-old kid, like crushing it. I was like, this is so legit.
Yeah.
Like I'm working from home. I got my own business basically.
Right.
And then the market crashed. The recession hit and like all these agents that were calling me, buying these websites, like completely stopped calling.
Wow.
Like nobody was calling anymore. People were canceling their websites. Like they were getting out of the business. Like the recession started hitting in a major, right. major
And what year was this in?
This was in 08, 09.
08, so that sounds about right.
Yep,
yeah.
Major recession kicked in. And then, so I was like, well, like if they kept doing the stuff that I told them to do and how the product works, they could still be getting business.
Right.
So I was like, you know what? I'm just going to take the same technology that I've been giving to these real estate agents and apply it and just do their job for them now, because they're all getting out of business.
Mm-hmm.
And I can get in now. Like there's a lot of space for me right. now to squeam in here. And then like the guy I was working with, the IBM guy, he's like, bro, you're correct. Like, you see what's going on.
You're the only one staying.
Yeah. Like, I don't think you know what you're doing.
Right.
Like the technology is good, but it's a bloodbath out there. So I was like, no, I'm good, man. I'll do it. I'll make it work somehow, some way. So then basically took that platform, applied it to myself, and I was generating leads. And like I focused, because I always try and like whatever I do, try and bring like a lot of value to people. Like my first thought is like, how can I help people the most in it? Because that's right. how you're going to become successful. So I looked at it like, wow, a lot of people are in trouble. And then I was like, found a real estate agent online who was like looking for an assistant.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, let me go work for that lady and then help her with the stuff that I know. She's experienced. She's a successful agent. I'll give my tools up and then she can show me the back end side of the paperwork, actually how exactly. to run a real estate business. So I did that. I was a real estate assistant for like 2 or 3 years. And then kind of partnered with that lady for a little while. And then we kind of just went separate ways. And then I just started my own real estate company. But through that time period, people might not even know, but like short sales, are you familiar with like a short sale? So short sale is when like there's a house and let's say you bought the house for 500 grand.
Okay.
You got a mortgage on the house, like the loan on the house, let's say the loan on the house is 400,000, but in the recession, your house is only worth maybe 200,000.
Wow.
So there's a $200,000 difference from how much you owe the bank to how much you can sell your house for.
Right.
So I was having to sell that house for 200,000 and have the bank waive $200,000 of debt from that person's life. And like at the time when I was first getting into it, like some of the banks didn't even have departments to like handle
that, because the recession was so new and
it was so new and the real estate market, the way it was operating, was all new. So that was my thing. I did that straight for like 2 or 3 years. Like every single transaction that I did, every single one was like either saving somebody because the bank was gonna like kick them out of their house like the next day. I would have to like negotiate with the bank to leave them and let them live in their house, or save them from going into foreclosure, or getting $200,000-$300,000 worth of debt removed from somebody's home.
And that was every day.
That was every
stressful. I would imagine it'd be stressful.
It was stressful. So that's happening. That's stressful, dealing and literally going into people's homes and seeing them cry with you at the table because they're about to lose their home, right. And they've got kids and they lost their job and there's just so much going on there. I'm a brand new, you know, real estate agent dealing with that whole situation, which is a whole nother thing. And then I've got my own family and own bills to pay while I'm trying to build this brand new business. Right. So like that, it was definitely like a stressful experience going through that and growing it and like kind of overcoming all of that to make it through.
Right.
But like that's why sometimes like now, like in like the third and fourth year of my career, like I was handling that sometimes like 12 deals at one time or something. And people are like, how do you remember? Like, and I didn't write it down. I didn't have everything was in my brain. Like, and they were like, how do you remember that? Like, one, because I'm emotionally connected to my clients. Like, I really want to see whatever's best for them, especially coming from how I was dealing with it before. But capacity wise for real estate, having to deal with the bank, attorneys, the court system, all of that. Like now, when I just sell a regular house, it's like, it's nothing. Like, it's nothing. It's easy. It's a no-brainer, the paperwork of it, compared to what I was doing before. So it kind of gave me a little bit of leverage handling that very, very difficult stuff for 2-3 years to be able to now come around when the market's kind of picking back up, stayed in contact, you know, with those same buyers, help them repair their credit, you know, seen them get new jobs, sometimes even connected them, and now they've grown and now they started buying houses again. Now they're back and everything just started circling around and coming full circle. And then that's how I basically built my real estate business.
Now it's crazy that you say that, you know, the reason why you remember so much because you were mostly invested, and people would question that is, I don't, you know, buying a house or buying a car or just buying anything big, we're always on Instagram, we're always on Facebook posting the happiest time and thanking the people who helped us get that car or purchase that house. So it's just reversal of that. You know, if that person's gonna appreciate you being there for selling them that product, they're gonna be even more appreciative when it's the tough times, you know, and you're sitting there trying to figure this out. Most people, I mean, don't even hear back from after they buy a big product like that, you know.
It's a big problem in our industry.
And during the recession, I mean, I would imagine, you know, you're still young, you know, so I'd imagine just sitting there just taking this all in, like say, your own personal life at home, just, oh man, just everything just, you know,
days going, you want to give up, man. You think there's no way I can make this. Like, there's no way. I'm going back to England. I'm packing this up. Like, if I'm going to struggle, I could just struggle with just friends and family. I'm here at this point, like solo with my own family, not really, you know, big support system, being able to have babysitters, like a lot of things. Whereas I'm at, and it was very, very, very.
And that time where you want, that time where you want to give up, and that when you're saying, you know what, I'm done, you know what I'm saying? That's usually you're about to cross that finish line where everything's just about to start just, you know, circling around, you know? And I think that's what it is. It's that entrepreneur mentality, you know? I mean, I'm at the same, at the time right now in my life, you know, I'm 28 years old, you know? I'm at that moment in my life where I'm tired of working, you know, the 9-to-5, you know? I'm tired of seeing that tradition go in my family. You know, I'm tired of working 9-to-5 and seeing people older than me doing the same thing. You know what I'm doing? So, you know, I'm picking the dream like you had, you know, and I'm just going at it, you know? And I think that's what a lot of people are missing nowadays, you know? It's crazy when you sit there and try to talk to people about entrepreneurship and they're just sitting there like, well, honestly, I'm cool with this. Like, it's the same paycheck every 2 weeks, and you're just like,
It's tough.
You know?
It's tough to hear it. And then, like, some people, you know, and everyone's not built to be entrepreneurs. No. Definitely not. Because it's rough.
It's very rough.
It's rough. But, like, I'd rather have the rough and have control of the rough than have the rough and not have no control
at all. Like, just being being unhappy. I always say, you know, God wasn't put me here to work for another man's dream.
Yeah.
That's my mentality. Like, yeah. Yeah. I wasn't built here to work for someone else's dream. I wasn't. If he got his own business and I'm working for him, then why can I not?
Yeah, do I look at everything like a partnership. Like anything I do, like some people be like, oh, well, you work at, you know, that real estate company. Like, no, I don't work there. Like, we're partners. Like,
right.
I pay them to use some stuff and they offer me service. Like, it's right. A give and take. It's different. Nobody can tell me to be anywhere at any time.
Right.
Like,
Was there something that at an early age that just made you want to do the entrepreneurship? Was it seeing your parents? Because obviously it sounds like your dad was kind of in the real estate industry in some sort of way.
Yeah, my real dad definitely is fully entrepreneurial spirit. Mm-hmm. Like, he would never have a job. I could never see that guy working for anyone.
Mm-hmm.
But then I also saw the other side of it with my stepdad, who was like full-fledged, like 9 to 5, 100%. So I saw both sides of it, and like obviously I leaned to more the entrepreneurial mm-hmm. side. Like it's just in my DNA. Like I just never could see myself having a career as like a job. Like
one time
my wife always laughs about it. Like one time when I went back to London when we was kind of in the transition, I was like, oh man, I need to make some money. Didn't have that much money, we're moving. Like, I was like, all right, let me see if I can get a job. And like, it was actually easy to get a job. Like, I was just like, hey, can I have a job? And
they were like, yeah, come on. Yeah, come on. We need people. We need people right now. Yeah.
It was in this store. That it was like, this is when I was way younger. But I was into sneakers a lot, right, when I was growing up especially. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to go and work in the sneaker store. Like, not even understanding, like, that's a retail job and, like, mm-hmm. how people treat you in that industry or whatever. So, like, I go get that retail job. I literally got the job. One day I was training. The second day they were like, all right, now you're like out on the floor. And then like these high school kids came into the store and was like, hey man, like go get me a size 5 or whatever it was. I was like, what? They're telling me what to do? I was like, bro, no, put me in the back. Like, put me in the back. I was like, bro, they put me in the back that day because I couldn't handle like the even telling me to go get them a pair of shoes. Like, I was like, no, I can't be on the floor. They sent me in the stock room. It was a mess down there, and I'm just like a finisher. Like, if I start something,
I have to finish it.
Like, I have to just go through. So I was like, I'm gonna organize this. Like, I organized the whole stock room in like a week, and then I was like, all right, bro, I quit. Like, I'm out here. Okay. All this stock room's looking nice for you now, though. I just did that like out of love. Like, I'm just gonna do it because like they hooked me up with a job. Mm-hmm. But that was in London. That was the longest job I've ever had, 7 days. And then when we actually moved to America. I worked at American Furniture Warehouse for like when I first came here because I like had to set up and like I didn't know what I was gonna do. I hadn't met the IBM guy yet and I needed a job to pay the bills, you know, obviously. Right. And that was brutal. Like, I mean, that was, you had to be there at work at 4 a.m. And that is the longest job I've ever had in America, and I did that for 9 months. That was rough.
Sales or
no? I was actually riding like the warehouse lifts and carrying like love seats and sofas on my back and throwing them in
4 a.m.
Yep, 4 a.m. to 3 p.m. every day. That was,
man,
that was the worst.
And it's like, crazy. There's still people there today.
There's still some people there that worked there when I worked there.
Man,
to this day, I go and see them. Yeah. And I'm like, and I remember like having conversations with that person, telling them like, hey, look, I'm gonna get into real estate industry. I'm gonna like, are you gonna be like, bro, you should get out. Like, what are you gonna do? How are you getting out of this?
It's crazy that you say it, because I say the same thing every day at work. I try to just motivate people. Like, when we sit there and we complain about our 9 to 5, I'd be like, well, I got my plan, you know. I'm doing this every Friday, you know. I'm doing this every Friday. I'm grinding. I'm reaching out to people, trying to meet new people, you know. And I'm just trying to tell people stories, where I'm trying to give everyone this perspective, you know. And sometimes they just look at you like
you're crazy.
Yeah,
like, no, man.
I'll be here Monday, you know. It's crazy because when you do that, when you have that entrepreneur mentality, and you're talking to people, and you're meeting people, that's how other doors open. That's how you meet up. That's how you get ideas. You know, like the Denver Gents, you know, and what you're doing with that, you know, and how that's just becoming something so big with Chauncey and everyone like that.
Yeah.
T- touch base on, you know, the whole Denver Gents and how, man, how that came to form. And
yeah, like a lot, you know, all of this stuff, like once, I think once you kind of get into the entrepreneurial mode and like you're really in gear and like stuff starts clicking, like your vision just keeps on expanding, and like you reach a goal, like I'm into vision boards and stuff, and then like you mm-hmm. cross off things off your vision board and you're like, what's next? Like, how am I gonna like get to the next level? And you always, you're trying to achieve different things. And then I was just kind of going through a phase in my real estate business where I had done all of that short sale, that really rough business, and now those clients had turned around. And then I had to kind of make a decision, like, do I want to stay in this lane and be like, not the average realtor, because in business wise, not, I'm not saying I'm better than anyone, but I'm probably above the average of like real estate agents already, but I'm above the average of the average, where mm-hmm. I wanted to be above the average of the best. Like, so, you know, I'm right. trying to get into a whole new lane into real estate. And like, that was actually a tough decision, because even having a successful industry or business, and then those people are kind of with you, and they've been with me for a whole journey, like from yeah. the ground to where I was at. And then you're like, okay, then I got referred by the VP, one of the VPs at Live Sotheby's, to like become an agent there, because they kind of saw what I was doing and thought I'd be a fit. And they approached me like almost a year and a half, actually 2 years ago, they approached me and was like, hey, do you want to be in this company? I know I'm kind of diverting, but I'm going to come back to the gents how it all kind of came in. So they've kind of told me to come on board, and I was like, oh, I don't know, like you guys do all that like high-end stuff, I don't just want to do that, I'm going to lose touch with my clients who you know have been with me, and I don't want to leave them behind, kind of thing. That was like my mental block in my mind. Long story short, I ended up like making the decision that I'm going to take the plunge into that. You know, and probably took a little bit of a hit on my business, and you know, people mentally don't know, like I still sell any house, any price point, you know, any person. It's just that now I have a lot more tools. But then at the same time, getting into that lane of real estate, now how do you crack into that market? Like, what, how do I stand out compared to the guy who's been in the game killing it in the luxury market for 10 years, right. 20 years, 30
right.
years,
right?
You know, and that whole market up, like this real estate market down here in Denver Metro on the ground selling regular houses is this big. That market up the top is like this big.
Yeah.
And there's like big dogs up there. So I was like, let me see what I can do. I need momentum. I need a squad. Like, we need to, like, my friends are already cooler than these guys. I'm just going to bring what we are. We're the cool kids.
Right.
Like, we're literally the cool kids. So Denver Gents was never like, it was never thought out to be what it is. It was literally, it started just as me doing marketing and bringing like my friends together to do something cool, so we could create some impact, some noise and stuff. So we just started an Instagram. Well, I started an Instagram page mm-hmm. and then started posting things on there, like just my friends dressed in suits and whatever. And then one of our buddies who's a part of the restaurant group, does events, Johnny, down at Mizu in Lohi, was like, oh man, I saw you like doing that Instagram page thing. We had like 30 followers on it. He's like, yeah, you should invite, like, get like 10, 15 of them, come, like, we'll hook you up, do like a dinner party for you guys. I was like, cool, man, thanks, that'll be cool. So he just wanted us all to kind of dress up in suits, come by the restaurant, take some pictures and stuff, kind of what we were doing online. So I was like, all right, that sounds cool. So we did like an Eventbrite page, set up the Eventbrite, and then kind of as that's going on, we're setting it all up, and then we send out an email to like everyone who's been following the page, like, hey, you know, this, we're going to get free food, like hook up at this restaurant. Right. Not free, means we're giving us a hookup. but then...
Everybody got to get their money, right?
Get their money, right? But then we went there, and then, as I said, it's supposed to be 15, 30 people, or 10, 15 people. like in the first week we had like 30 people register. Like somebody told their friend like, hey, I'm dressing up in a suit and going here, you wanna come? You wanna come? And then like the day before the event we had like 150 people register to come to the event.
And it was only supposed to be 30.
Yes, maximum 30. The journey was like a maximum 30 people, bro.
Yeah.
I was like, all right. And then I told him, bro, there's like 160 registered. I was like, yeah, the table we have reserved, can we like move, like, can we do it into the bar area maybe now? Like, right. We'll just do cocktails and sushi or something.
Right.
And then like probably like 80, 90 people showed up to the event. Wow. Like, this is no promo. This is no Facebook ads, no IG ads. This is literally just
word of mouth.
We had 30 people following the page.
Right.
We had 160 people sign up and 90 people show up to the event. And then that day, everyone's like, so when's the next event, man? Like, when are we doing this again? I was like, again? Like, what are we doing? Like, this wasn't a thing. Like, last week, this wasn't even a thing.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
So then everyone wanted to do it again. And I was like, man, this is cool. Like, because not only was it cool because I was getting to hang out with, like, my friends and stuff that right. I know. It was kind of cool for Denver to see, like, because me, we would go out, like, as separate groups. Like, maybe two or three of us go out. We normally get dressed up anyway. That's just kind of, like, how we like to get before we go out. But, like, seeing that many people in one place for Denver, when Denver, people think of it as, like, a cow town.
Yes.
Nobody gets dressed up here.
Mountains, cowboys.
It's the mountains, exactly.
Desert, you know.
It was a big deal. So, kind of ended up, you know, looking cool visually. We took some pictures and then after that, my buddy Stuart, who was kind of helping me with the IG page, because I wanted to get consistent posts. So I was like, man, I can't post this work, real estate. I was just so busy with
right.
stuff. So we would just take turns posting pictures on the page. And then we kind of just sat down and we were having a meeting about what we were doing and like, what, you know, what is Denver Gents now? Like, we did
right,
this.
Right, when
we
people had to, ask, what are we?
Yeah, what? Who are we? Like, what right. is this? Because people were asking us, what is this? And we were right. like, you know, this is some friends. We got
just dressing up. Yeah, yeah.
So I was like, we was just like, nah, that's not cool. Like, we can't be like, why are we getting dressed up for? Like, we got to have a reason. Like, we're good. Like, everyone in the group is a cool person. Like, you know, we're quote unquote successful, like we have opportunities ahead of us. Like, if we're gonna do this and be out, let's create some awareness, let's give back, let's help, let's make some real change. Like
right.
yeah, we're changing how people see Colorado, but let's also help change the community at the same time and help the youth and help, you know, men that are going through stuff and different things like that.
Right.
So literally the next event that we didn't tell anyone it was a secret location, didn't say any details. But we ended up planning an event. It was downtown at the Clock Tower. They have yep. an event space at the very top of the clock, which is like you're inside the clock. Like when you're standing there, you can see the clock faces. Like a really, really cool
nice.
Space. And you can step outside of the clock and be like full 360
right.
views of Denver. So we did like an event concept where it's like secret location. There was like a password to enter. We did it kind of cool. But what we didn't tell people is that day, because of like our idea and what we thought and what we're going to do to try and impact the community, we were like, well, let's charge them, but we'll take the money and we'll donate it to charity. Like, because like none of the Denver Gents or me or anyone like gets paid or has a salary or anything. So we were like, we're not going to take any money. We're just going to take whatever funds us and our friends put together. And we'll just, you know, we'll be able to make a bigger impact with people doing it that way. So when everyone got there, we just took a moment to kind of tell everyone that. And then we had order forms for people. I think we had like maybe 40 people at that event. And we were like, let's, you know, there's 40 people there. You know, we'll announce this, pay, you know, you got to pay. Now people get like touchy, like, about,
yeah,
you
yeah.
know, nobody wants to pay for
everyone
stuff.
Everyone wants everything.
Everyone wants for everything for free.
You know?
So we're like, let's see, $150. We'll see if they want to pay to keep doing this or whatever. So it was like 40 people, 20 people will probably sign up. Let's print 30 forms just in case. Print the 30 forms. We're like, hey, there's forms here. It's $150 for the year. We'll keep doing cool stuff like this, but we're going to donate all the money to charity. Who wants to sign up?
So if you printed 30 and all 30 paid the 150 50.
Yes.
That's the one-time fee, and then you guys...
For the year. Yep.
And then you guys just keep running these events, and it's just the same thing. Now, do you guys try to be like... those people that sign up. So say if I signed up.
Yep.
You know, I guess it would be kind of my thing to be like, tell one of my friends, hey, man, come check this out.
Exactly. You know? So, I mean... So that day, all 30 forms left the building, signed up right there on the spot. Mm-hmm. The other 10 people were like, where's my form? So we were like, okay, everybody wants to do this.
This is something.
It's something. This is something. Now we know, like, they're willing to pay to have this experience, and we're making change, and it's super cool. We was like, let's just keep doing it. So we kept doing it. I have never sold anyone or told anyone to sign up to be a Denver Gent. Never. People are like, oh, how do I sign up? I just say, go to the website, man. Because I don't want to have to convince you to give to charity or convince you to get dressed up or any of this stuff. Like, you have to want it.
Right.
Yeah, you got to want to be a part of something like this. But we do have, like, the last event that we did was the art show event. And that was like a public event where anyone from the public could kind of come through the event. We were selling art that day, and funds from the art sales were going to go to charity. And then when people came in there that day, we had like a little table where, like, if you want to sign up, because you can see like what it is and what kind of stuff that we do, you can sign up. But we don't, like, I don't even know what type of promotion we would do. I haven't even thought about it, but we don't do it.
Right.
Nothing. It's just literally word of mouth and somebody saying, like, I care about Denver, I care about the community, I care about the kids and their future, and $150 is worth me making this change and this impact to the community.
Now, what are some of the notable charities that you guys have done to, or is there a specific one that you guys
go to? We're not like fixed to one charity. Mm-hmm. We are heavily involved in the Porter Billups Foundation.
Shout out to Chauncey.
Shouts out to Chauncey and Coach Porter. Like, Lonnie is a legend. Like, that guy is an absolute legend in Denver. And, like, what he does and the energy that he still has and his commitment to making change in kids' lives. Like, he was running that charity, you know, prior to Chauncey getting involved. And Chauncey actually approached him to be involved. And Chauncey is, like, taking the charity to a whole nother level.
Right.
You know, brand awareness and bringing in, you know, great sponsors.
He does so much for the community. It's awesome. So much.
Absolutely.
You know, so much.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Like, their whole team is just, like... Right. And the thing is like what they do with the kids in their summer camp that they run is like all to do with like real life skills, like manners, like real world, like job training, you know, finance, banking, mortgage, you know, that summer camp that they run is like us as the Denver Gents, our inspiration to like be able to implement a small, you know, a class or some type of education that we can go around and share. So that's why we're so heavily involved with those guys, is because their vision matches completely what our vision is. But, you know, within the group itself, we're always open to, like, one of the gents might come and say, hey, man, I'm a part of this charity. Right. Like, can we do an event to kind of help raise awareness about, you know, so the art show we did, Step Denver. There was a couple of gents that had been gone through rehabilitation, and that's what that company is about. So we were like, yeah, definitely, like, let's do an event, raise awareness for that, you know, be able to write them a check, help out some men that are going through stuff. So we're open to different charities, but definitely, I mean, our main focus is youth and boys and girls, not just
men. We'll definitely have to, you know, talk later on, because I'm really big, and it's probably just been after this past years, I'm really big on the way, you know, raising awareness for mental health.
Okay.
You know, I think that's something big. You know, I personally have never, you know, dealt, you know, with mental health or seen or known anyone like that, but you just see it so much now. And you just see, you know, so much stories. It's becoming common now.
Yeah,
you know?
It's very common. It's crazy. Like, I speak to, like, my friends in England about this, because, like, in England, like, my life growing up, like, it was, like, to make it easy and not go into too much detail, but like I would say it's like Kendrick, isn't it? Like good kid, bad city type, grow like, right. Yeah, I had a good family kind of stuff, but then like you're so close to like the madness, right, of life in London and what it is as a city. But like I literally could tell you that probably 20-30% of the people that, like, now we're adults and like we look at like our class, let's say our high school graduating class or whatever, of dudes that, you know, was your clique or whatever,
right,
at school, are literally like mentally sick.
Yeah,
like their health, like you can, like
you maybe, can tell, you can tell, yeah, yeah,
you 100% can see, right, it in the flesh. So it's like when you get older and you start looking at things like that, it really, like you said, yeah, it's like, wow, man. Like,
yeah,
how, and life is stressful and like you can see how it can happen. But yeah, I don't think people address it enough and understand what it is to even, you know, people are scared to like say like, hey, man, like, you know, you should see a doctor or you need, right, to see a psychologist or you might need to take some medication or whatever it is.
Right.
Like people are getting, that subject is kind of taboo.
It's taboo. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. We'll definitely have to talk, yeah, you know, and I would love, like I said, I would love to get involved and everything like that. So how can, you know, so we can move on and everything like that, how can people get involved if they, you know, if they are interested in doing the Denver Gents and everything like that?
Yeah, for Denver Gents, just go to denvergents.com is the website, or you can follow the Instagram page, Denver Gents. Mm-hmm. Everything is just Denver Gents. So yeah. Denver Gents on Instagram. There's a Facebook group that we kind of use, but it's mainly the website and Instagram. Right. You can find out everything, yeah, you need to know.
What would you say is the most difficult part about entrepreneurship?
For me personally at this stage, I would say it's the work family balance.
Work family balance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Do you also use that as motivation?
Definitely. Yeah. Definitely. Like I'm sacrificing a lot right now. I'm sacrificing, right, time, which is one of the most precious things.
Right.
To be able to create the vision that I do have, where I do have way more time with my family, like, mm-hmm, I'm having to sacrifice that up front in a major capacity to be able to enjoy it on a way bigger scale later, right, on in life. So I would say that's probably my biggest, because I'm a workaholic. Like I could stay up till 4 a.m. and wake up at 6 a.m. and get right back to it
again, yeah,
and always work. And sometimes when you're working as an entrepreneur and you love what you do, you don't even realize that you're working.
Yeah,
as
it's much not work.
Right, it's not work. Mm-hmm. So I'm just doing it and I'm having fun, and my family sees it as work, and I'm like, I'm not working. Like, you don't, yeah, even think when about it. When you're
coming
it.
Home from work.
Yeah, and then you're like checking working? Your email you real quick working? And you're like replying, yeah, to a client, you're texting, but the, right, client's your friend.
Right.
So it's just like normal conversation. Mm-hmm. So being able to like just actually not check my phone or like actually say I'm home, I'm just not gonna do anything,
right,
is what I'm working towards, which it will happen, but right now we gotta get it, right?
Yeah. how would you put, you know, like anyone struggling or anyone having that mindset where they want to take that entrepreneurship road, or it's the mentality but they just don't know how to approach it, you know, If you could give it any advice, or what would you say to any entrepreneur in the making or just inspired to be one, what would you say is the biggest lesson or the biggest thing to take away from it?
Yeah, the biggest key, number one, is like you gotta believe it. Like whatever you do, you 100% have to believe in it. Like you already have to see it as a success before any person else. Because people are going to tell you no 50 million times.
Right.
You're going to get shut down. It's not going to work. You're going to have to regroup. So one, you got to believe in yourself. Two, you cannot be afraid to try. Like, you got to just do it. Like, you can't just talk about it. You, right, cannot. That's what the mistake is. People love to talk about what they're about to do. That time that you've been talking about it, there's somebody that's done it five, right, times.
Yeah, you can't wait for the train. The train's going to keep going without you. It's
going to keep going. You know? So you got to believe in it and then just do it. Right. And if you do that, and then along the way, you find good people and you offer value and you lead with value, like whatever you're going to do, like make sure it's going to help someone. Like,
Right.
Whatever it is, it's got to make some real change. Like, in, as entrepreneurs, like, I hear all the time, because I listen to podcasts like this and different things. Like, one of the biggest things, like, I always hear entrepreneurs say is, like, entrepreneurs have, like, the ability to, like, solve the world's problems. Like, no 9-to-5er is going to solve world issues, right? So, knowing that, I always just, I keep that in the back of my mind. Like, damn, that heavy weight of that responsibility, I'm a part of that. Like, right. I have to do, if I'm doing gents, I've got to make sure Denver Gents is here to try and change the world. If I'm doing real estate, I got to be so emotionally connected that I can change that person's life for the better. Yeah. So you got to want to do things that's going to help people elevate, as well as believe and then find good people around you. So it's, you know, it's hard to, like, you know, they say if you had one tip, would you, you know, what would you do? It's like, there's so many things, but just be always be open to growing and kind of just, it's a very fluid thing, man. You got to, you know, one day it's this, next day it's that. You got to be just ready to always just go, just go and ask questions.
Awesome. Yeah, never be afraid to ask. Yeah. Right? I think a lot of people have to say, and, you know, we all do it, you know, hey, I'm a homeowner, you know, and shit gets stuck around the house, man.
Oh,
it gets
fixed.
I want to fix it by myself. I guess I sit there, I get frustrated.
Yeah, yeah.
My wife always tells me, just go ask somebody. You know?
Someone.
And you get to put that pride to, you know, to the side. Now, I don't even have a pride issue.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're men, you know, we want to fix stuff around the house
ourselves.
But hey, sometimes stuff ain't getting fixed, you know? So yeah, definitely.
But there's YouTube these days, so you can find, like,
YouTube, Google, anything.
YouTube and Google. Like, sometimes some of the questions people ask me, I even had this on my Instagram when I did, like, the question thing not too long ago. It's like, they're like, oh, how do you get a real estate license? So, like, they're asking basic, very basic questions. It's cool to ask those questions, maybe, like, if you're in a conversation to maybe lead into, like, what you want to, you know, you want to get more in depth. But, like, try and ask the real question, you know, like, skip over that, because you can find that on
YouTube.
You
have your resource.
You can find, like, and if you, that's a part of the entrepreneurial spirit, is kind of figuring some stuff out by yourself.
Right.
That's an entrepreneur. Like, we figure stuff out by ourselves, and meaning we might not actually physically figure it out, but I'm going to figure out the way or the tool that I need to fix the problem. So, like, you can't, you should be able to Google some things and go on YouTube and find some stuff out. And then as it gets, the bigger problems you get, you need more help and more people.
Right.
But, yeah.
Good. Awesome. Well, we got a new segment I want to try with you, Delroy.
Okay.
We call this Off the Top.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you 10 questions.
All right.
And I don't even want you to think about it.
Okay.
Just boom. All
right.
And we'll ask them and then we'll go into it.
I'm a straight shooter we're
good. Okay. You ready?
Yep.
London or America?
America.
Skinny tie or bow tie?
Neither.
Neither.
No.
Favorite actor, and give me your best impression of him.
Oh, Will Smith. I can't do no impressions.
No, you can't give me one.
I can't even remember. I should have been at a barbecue. That was from Independence
Day. There you go. Favorite vacation spot?
I don't have a favorite yet.
No. Best memory of a vacation spot?
Jamaica.
Favorite design style of a house that you want to sell?
Oh, modern.
Modern. LeBron James or Michael Jordan?
LeBron James.
Man, we gonna be best friends there, right? Favorite celebrity crush growing up?
Aaliyah.
Aaliyah, ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh. We become best friends though, right? Big parties or small gatherings?
Both.
Big parties or staying at home?
Staying at home.
Stay at home. Money or free time?
Both.
Both. Beach or mountains?
Both. Both an option. Sorry. I want it all, man.
You want it all. I don't blame you. Now, those are the 10 questions. Now, I want to go back. No skinny tie or bow tie, huh?
Nah, I see, like, I had like a quick small moment where I was like into bow ties, but like you gotta be so specific, and like then I started getting more educated about fashion too. Like I actually like with the and the reason that I actually started the Denver Gents is I actually started becoming very like aware and educated on fashion and stuff. Like I literally watched YouTube videos and like how to style and what to wear, and started following IG pages and people, and that's how I found out even about Suit Supply, the company where I shop a lot, and I actually work with them. They kind of have me as a brand ambassador to like wear their clothing now.
What Suit Supply?
So Suit Supply is...
Well, what location?
Oh, in Cherry Creek.
It's funny that you say that. Okay. And we'll get back to that. But so I'm about to hit my 1 year anniversary with of our wedding last year.
Okay.
So when I proposed and we started planning everything, I said I want a maroon suit.
Okay.
You know. I'm searching everywhere.
Yeah.
I'm going to I'm hitting the local spots. You're playing a wedding. You're trying to stay cheap, you know?
Yeah.
Nowhere is saying it. Nowhere. So we're at Cherry Creek, and some guy goes, "Try Suit Supply across the street." So I go in there, and I'm like,
it's like a rainbow. Like dang, everything.
You know? And I'll never forget her name, but her name is Nicole Valdez.
Yep. Shouts out Nicole. It's the squad right there.
I explained to her what I needed, you know, and we were picking out colors, and she said, "When's the wedding?" I said, "September," and we're hitting like late June.
So
she looks, and she says, "It's coming from Italy, so the soonest it can get here is the first week of September." Now our wedding was in September 23rd.
Okay.
She said, "But it could come a week sooner." Before.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, well, if it comes a week before, I got to get alterations, right. You know, all that, you know.
Yeah, oh yeah.
But something in my gut says, just do it.
Yeah.
So we went ahead and did it. And the whole time I'm stressing, you know, she said it's coming from Italy, you know, she's measuring me. And she called me the last week of August. And she said, hey, Andrew, it's Nicole. And I was like, oh, what?
It's going to give you some bad news.
Yeah. She said, the suit is here.
Yay.
I said, what?
Done.
Came down there. She alterated me. And she saved it, you know.
Because
like I said, I couldn't find it nowhere, you know. And the fact that she pulled together. So I haven't talked to her since after the wedding. I sent her some pictures. So please, you know, if Nicole watches this or you see Nicole, then, you know, tell her I said I appreciate it, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
But,
The Suit Supply is like my extended family, man.
Yeah.
Like, big time. They got a big culture in there. So, like, I mean, just to close out on a question, and, like, if we want to talk about Suit Supply, we can. But I became more educated into fashion. Then I started watching the show Suits. Have you ever seen that?
No, I haven't.
Netflix Suits?
No.
Oh, my gosh. You need to watch that show. Bro, that show is so sick. Anyway, there's these two characters in there.
Right.
And then Harvey Specter, he would like, it's like about these New York big time attorneys. Yeah. And like there was a rookie attorney and he'd rock like the skinny ties. And then like the big heavyweight attorneys would rock like the real life big ties. I was like, I'm rocking big ties.
Big ties.
I'm not rocking no skinny ties no more. And then like as I got more educated into fashion, it was like skinny ties are more like high street. And then like the more regular size ties are more like high end stuff.
Yeah.
So, it's just a thing because I'm so into it now. It's just a whole thing for me.
So I guess the best thing or the main thing I want, you know, to ask you is, what do you want people to know about Delroy Gill?
Oh, man. That's a good question. Really that, you know, I busted my ass, like, in a major, like, do not be fooled by what you see and just the presence of like the brand, if you want to call it. Mm-hmm. Like behind the scenes, the struggle was real to get to where I'm at right now. And even to me personally, where I'm at right now is nowhere even near where I want to be. Like, I have to like take it in for a moment and be like, wow, you know, you've come a long way, but like it took a lot. It took a lot to get to where I'm at, and like it was minimal help in terms of the support system. So I have not done this by myself at all. Like my wife holding down the family, keeping all the house running, and then me having to build, you know, I'm in a brand new country. Like I had to build a whole new support system and people around me and build new relationships to even help me get to where I'm at today. So just anyone who's seen this and thinks like, or that they know me, like it's more for like people that don't know me, that, you know, it's hard to condense everything, you know, in a one podcast interview of what, you know, it took to get here. Like there's major things in my life that I don't even promote or talk too much about, that are like big milestones for me personally, but it's a lot of work, and you have to work hard and believe in yourself to get to where you're at, wherever it is.
Delroy, let them know where they can follow you. Tell them about one more time about the Denver Gents, and just let them know if they have any questions or if they have any inspirations. Just let them know the social medias and everything like that.
Definitely, man. So most of my stuff everywhere is just my name, Delroy Gill, DelroyGill, Delroy Gill on Instagram, Delroy Gill on Facebook, Delroy Gill on YouTube, everywhere out there. My foundation now, is crazy to even say I have a foundation, is the Denver Gents. You can find that on denvergents.com. You can find it on Instagram, Denver Gents, on Instagram as well. And really, like, shouts out to everyone that's around, that's been kind of behind the scenes, or even some people in front of the scenes that they might not know how much they do. Like everyone down at Suit Supply, Shinola, Watch Brand in Cherry Creek Mall, my business partner on Denver Gents, Stuart. My company that I'm with, Liv Sotheby's, the backing and push that they've given me. And everything I post really and truly is for inspiration, like to show that it can happen with hard work. And I'm an open book. Like if anybody follows me on IG or whatever and they just want to inbox me a question, or, you know, people do that type of stuff, I'll reply. Like I reply to everyone.
You did for me.
Yeah, I'm there. I respond to everything. I never want to be too big, like, because I'm telling you, I'm a person that asks questions. Like I've spoken to some people where I'm like, people ask me like, how did you meet or speak? Yeah. I was like, I just DM'd him, man. I just asked a question. Yeah. So just, yeah, people can do that to me. Ever. I never want to be to the point where I can't ask a question, but I do understand as well with limited time. I love doing stuff like this because I can reach a big audience without having, you know, taking up more of my family time as well. Right. So I can do this. This can get viewed, you know, who knows how many times. Right. Whereas me doing one-on-ones is a little bit tougher these days on me. So I always want to help though people.
That was good. Appreciate it, brother.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Man. Thank
you. Appreciate it.
All right. Thank you guys for watching. Please subscribe, like, follow. Follow me, DrewSmith_ Twitter, Instagram. Follow Delroy Gill. Next week, we got Kayla and Greg Kimball from KMG Studios. Very good friends of mine. We're going to be talking about their entrepreneurship as well. And I appreciate everyone. And you guys have a safe weekend. Delroy, once again, thank you, brother.
Thank
Seth,
you.
I appreciate it. And we are good. Have a good night, guys. And we'll see you guys next week.
Peace.